All right, right from on. Great. All right, thank you. Thanks for coming out tonight. We'd like to think that all of our concerts are special, but this one is extra special as we're, as you see on the program, you probably know already that we're that are paying a tribute all night, as much as we can, to the legend that was Butch Miles. And we'll talk a lot about him as we go along the concert. But I do want to recognize all the people that played on that first one, which is a great tune by one of my favorite composers, Canadian composer by the name of Rob McConnell, who wrote that tune. I tried to look up what the title of that tune meant. Couldn't find anything. The liner notes were of no use. So the rare time the liner notes don't come through. But anyways, that featured, starting on guitar, was Austin Lytle. On the trumpet, Thomas Schaefer. He always travels well, as I say. On the tenor sax, Joseph Stratemeyer. On the bass, what? A bass solo on the first tune? Yeah, Mr. David Hine. And of course, you can't do, you can't kind of remember Butch Miles on that without having lots of drum solos. And that one, the drum solos were handled by Mr. Evan Luna. All right, we got a lot of great music to get to as well. So this next tune is from the band of Duke Ellington, who wrote quite a few songs, well, not quite a few, but a few different tunes that kind of were evocative of trains. And this one is from what was his Deep South Suite that he first premiered at Carnegie Hall in 1946. There will be a little quiz afterwards, because you'll definitely hear a tune in here that you recognize. I won't give it away yet, but I'm sure, no matter what age you are, you've heard some of this tune before. But this is Duke Ellington's Happy Go Lucky Local. Thank you. All right, thanks. In true good Bellinger fashion, that featured a ton of people. You'll hear all their names later on in the concert too, so we will do that now. So, of course, the quiz is like, what tune did you hear in there that you've heard before? Yeah, Night Train, right? That first became a hit in 1951 for Judy Forrest. Oddly enough, Judy Forrest in 1949, for about 3 or 4 months, had been a saxophone player in the Duke Ellington Orchestra. Go figure. And magically, 3 years later, had a big hit with Night Train. And there have been, you know, kind of countless hits since then on the tune Night Train. And, you know, Duke Ellington can always do what happened. He was always a little bummed that Judy Forrest didn't give him any credit. But Billy Ellington was doing all right as a composer, so he didn't press matters any further. But that was, you know, it's kind of an interesting happenstance how that works. So we're going to just change gears real quick here and go to a much more modern composer, a trombonist by the name of Ben Patterson, who was formerly of the Airmen of Note, which is the United States Air Force premier jazz band. And he writes a lot of great tunes. This is a tune called Small Note Boogaloo. Thank you. was going to wait a second for it to come on there. All right, on the baritone saxophone is Mr. James Rubino. And on the guitar is Mr. Aiden Potter. Now, so it's definitely true. There's so many stories about Butch Miles that, I mean, you can't hope to ever condense them into one night or one, you know, day or even one week. Like, there's just a million things out there. I'd asked some of my colleagues who have worked with Butch for some of their best Butch stories. Hank Hemsoff, our piano professor, sent me one that I had never heard before and was pretty crazy, both for Hank and just for Butch in general. So I just wondered real quick from Hank. So they had just returned from jazz studies at Eastman to Austin and was getting all kinds of calls for gigs. It was mid-afternoon on a Saturday, I got a call to sub for Count Basie. Now, this alone sounds crazy, but the Basie band toured all over the place. If Count Basie got sick, I mean, it's not like the band is just going like, well, forget it, we're not going to play it. So on the rare occasions that they got a sub for Count Basie, they're playing at the Texas Union Ballroom for a sock hop. I think it was around 1976. And Hank said, I reluctantly said yes, because I didn't know much about the Basie band. He was 23, he said, I'm 23, but I looked like I was 15. When I showed up for the sound check, everyone in the band looked at me like, no. And the thing was, as Hank says, you know, Count Basie didn't have music. It was his band. He didn't have like a book of like, here's all the piano charts. He just knew all the charts. So Hank didn't have any music. So Freddie Green, the guitar player, you know, gave him his book and said, all right, you can read from mine. Freddie Green certainly didn't need it either. And Butch, he said, Butch came over to him before the gigs. He put his arm around him and said, it's all right, man, we'll make it work. And he said, after the sound check a couple tunes, everyone relaxed and knew that everything would be great. So the audience was great. So one funny thing was he didn't know the typical Basie ending, the little dun, gun, gun, which Count Basie plays on the end of almost every other tune. He said every time they get to the end of the tune, he just played like a big flurry of notes and everything. Because he had no clue. Everyone in the band thought that was pretty funny, but he didn't quite catch on. But he said that, you know, one of the calming influences on that very first gig, like Butch said, hey, it'll be cool. We'll be fine. We'll get through it. And of course they did. And of course everyone else in the band is great, so you can't go wrong. Like with Butch having your back, you knew you were always in good shape. Over his time with the Basie band, from 75 to 79, I mean, over the hundreds of gigs we played, Butch played just about every tune that was in the Count Basie book, including this one, which has always been a real favorite of mine. And this was for all the great things that Quincy Jones has done. This song is arrangement of that Quincy Jones' very first Grammy. Quincy Jones has 28 Grammys, by the way. He has the most of any living person. But his very first one is in 1964 for the Count Basie Orchestra, arranging the old country tune, I Can't Stop Loving You. So here's one of our Basie tunes in our tribute to Butch here with the Count Basie arrangement of I Can't Stop Loving You. mean, there's no way you could not love that, right? It's great stuff. On the trombone, Mr. Lyle Moss. Playing the top AC role over there on piano, James LaRue. And laying down that great shuffle there on the drums, Anthony Pacheco. One of the things you also do if you're kind of paying tribute to Butch now is you have to do something where the drums get even more time to shine there. This next tune will do that. We played this a few weeks ago when we got the extreme fortune to open up for the Duke Ellington Orchestra, who was our guest artist for our jazz festival about 3 weeks ago. Yeah, if you were there at the concert, you were certainly in for quite a treat. The DEO was on point, they killed it. But we had a great opening set too. We played a couple tunes open for them. This is one of them. That's an old Clifford Brown tune called The Blues Walk, done in the Latin style by a great arranger named Michael Philip Mossman. So here's The Blues Walk.
Thank you.
All right. Of course, we're about to have two great drummers back there. Anthony Pacheco and Evan Lennox. Thank you. Thank you, the soloist. That was Joseph Sternmeyer. There's Cesar Matana on guitar. We're going to play, but they're a little long enough to be introduced in a minute. So, I love the choreography there. On the flute, Michelle Betancourt. I don't know if 19 years is long enough now to not make a Ron Burgundy reference anytime there's jazz flute, but you know, I think we're getting there. Probably some of you don't even know the now, so I guess that is, hey, has been long enough. James Rubino again on the Barry Sax. And on the five is Bernardo Bucetti. So, a couple of my best kind of Butch memories, and of course there were a lot. Butch was already here when I got here, so I was kind of the new one coming in. Butch was already, had already been here for a while and was already established. And it was like, wow, I get to work with Butch Miles. Like, this is pretty amazing. And every year we did our Eddie Durham tribute concert, I got to play with Butch. And I got to play with Butch at other gigs and played with his Jazz Express a few times and got to play with Butch, but I knew at least once a year I was going to get to play with Butch, which as a bass player, I mean, it basically made it effortless. I was just kind of drafting behind him. Like, he would play, I was like, okay, if I keep up with him, I'm doing good. And he made everything feel fantastic. The one time I only got to hear him play with the bass he did once, unlike some of my colleagues who have heard it many times, that was when, in 2019, when the Basie Band was our guest artist here for the Jazz Festival. So it's February 2019, just about 4 years ago, and they invited Butch up to play a tune. And when we had heard of his passing, one of the first tune that came to my mind, one that wasn't even going to be on the program, said, all right, we'll have to do this tune instead, was they called about me to play the Corner Pocket, which is just one of the kind of quintessential Count Basie tunes. And in my mind, I can always, you know, at least picture him playing that and just the absolute joy on his face to getting up there and playing. And it was like he was 30 again. He was just like a rejuvenated man and sounded amazing as always. I wanted to make sure Evan played this. Evan was basically pretty much his last jazz drum set student here. So Evan was fortunate enough to be able to work with Butch and, I mean, all of our students that did over the 14 years that he was here were just so, you know, lucky in so many ways, even if they didn't quite appreciate, you know, all of what Butch had done and what all he meant. Like, they appreciated his empathy and his caring as a teacher. He was just one of the nicest people you'd ever met, cared so much about his students, really just wanted nothing but the best for them. You'd never know, oh, this is one of the world's greatest drummers. Like, he did not carry himself like that. When he was here, he was a teacher. He was so supportive of this band, of all of our bands, of all of our students. He was just, you couldn't ask for a better colleague. So this is another little tribute to him. This is Corner Pockets. Thank you. too. You can listen to this bassy stuff and not enjoy it. Okay, if you like jazz, if you like swing, it's just great stuff. That's on the drums, Evan Luna. Again, pumping all the bassy stuff, which is not as easy as it sounds. Not only playing in the key of A flat, but a lot of the weird kind of spread tenths that are things. James LaRue.
Yeah.
Back there in the dueling trumpets, yeah, Brandon Barbie and Thomas Schaefer. You gotta learn from the guitar players, so stay up there until your interviews. And on the tenor saxophone, Olivia De La Rosa. Overstating like how this great of a person Butch was. You know, we can all go down like YouTube rabbit holes and watch him playing and everything. Like him being an amazing drummer is, you know, like almost beside the point. Like, yeah, he was. I mean, playing with Mel Torme and then Tom Basie with Dave Brubeck right after that. I mean, plus just the litany of people that he played with, the who's who of jazz. But Butch was always happy, always smiling, always glad to tell you something good. And never once did anybody hear him say anything bad about other jazz players, about other people, which, I mean, in the realm of jazz musicians, isn't real common. Like, there's always, yeah, sometimes there's a little snippy, but it's kind of competitive sometimes. And Butch was like the nicest, always stayed above the fray. He had nothing but good things to say about everyone. I mean, always, rightfully so, had just great things to say about his students and about the students here. So we were really lucky. The one story that I just heard back in a few weeks ago, we had our celebration when Doug Lawrence was here from the Tom Basie Orchestra, who had known Butch for decades and decades. And maybe this is just kind of an apocryphal tale, but when Butch got hired to the Tom Basie Orchestra, he actually wasn't originally the drummer that was supposed to be hired. They hired somebody else who couldn't make it the first week or so. And so Buddy Rich and Mel Torme had both recommended Butch to kind of be the fill-in. And so he came and he played the first couple of gigs. And like the first gig sat down, didn't need the music, like knew all the charts already. I mean, he loved Tom Basie Orchestra. Didn't need music, played every one of them perfectly. And like basically after the first night, you know, Basie said, well, you know, we need to figure out something to do with the other drummer because this guy's got to be our drummer. I mean, there's no doubt about that. So for the next 4 years, he was. Luckily, there's a lot of recorded material, a lot of albums that got put out, mostly on the Pablo label that you can still easily get with Butch playing with the Basie band back then. He also played later on from, I think, 97 to 2007, played again with them as a touring band after Tom Basie had died. But his recorded album with them is great. And there are, thanks to YouTube, plenty of videos of him playing. Whirlybird tends to be the most popular one. They played it at the Montreux Jazz Festival. That's probably the first one that comes up if you search Butch, which I recommend you do, because it is this like mind-blowing stuff. It is amazing. We are going to change direction a little bit here and do a little more modern tune by a great composer named Maria Schneider. And this tune, again, you're looking at the name of the tune, but it doesn't seem to make much sense. There's actually a painting by the great and surrealist painter Paul Klee back in 1922 called Dance You Monster to My Soft Song. So this was named for that painting, if that's, you know, there's, doesn't seem to be any other story to that, but there is a little arch tie in there. So this is going to feature some guitars, some trumpet. This will be very different from most of the other stuff we do, but that's the great thing about jazz. It's not all the same. So here is Dance, You Monster, to My Soft Song. Thank you. So again, quite some of my colleagues are very jealous of what they got to see the Basie Band like back in the heyday of the Basie Band. I'm not humble right to say I'm not old enough to have seen that, but I kind of wish I had. So the first time I heard Basie was right after Butch had just joined the band, so about 75 or so, and it was a life-changing experience. Never heard a band before or since swing like that, or heard another group of any genre play so dynamically. Man, isn't that the truth? So I got three autographs that night: Count Basie, Freddie Green, and Butch. There's a pretty good rhythm section, man. I heard Butch and Basie several other times after that, and I always thought it was special. Because I don't remember the exact year he hired him, but I think it was 2007. I remember when a local piano player told me they had just played a gig in Seguin, and Butch Miles was there. He was like, "The Butch Miles?" And I was like, "Well, all right." And then thankfully, Keith reached out and talked to Butch and asked him to come teach here, and Butch was more than happy to oblige. And we, you know, started that 14-year experience with Butch, which was fantastic. Now, it's good. So after starting to Texas State, I told people about including them, you know, including many prominent drummers like Ed Sof, who was the drum instructor at University of North Texas for a long time, and their response was always, "The Butch Miles?" But they couldn't believe, like, "Butch Miles is here teaching at Texas State?" Yeah, that's what it was. Yeah. And the drummer I worked with since when he was a student at Berkeley, he studied Butch as part of his jazz drum degree. Like, he was part of the curriculum, which absolutely he should be. And Keith kind of echoed my sentiments too. So in addition to being one of the greatest drummers in history, he's even one of the nicest people I had ever known. I don't think I ever heard Butch say anything negative about others or others about Butch, too. Nobody ever had bad words to say about him, for sure. His smile and positive attitude were infectious. My life has been better because of Butch. And man, I think everyone that's ever met him can say that for sure. Butch made everyone better, both musically and just, you know, personally, too. Like, you know, if you weren't able to, you know, get a chance to meet him, you know, it's a shame, because he was just a wonderful person. And again, we wouldn't do something like this for just anybody. We wouldn't have, you know, so many stories, you know, that would go on for days, and I could call all kinds of people up here that would all have a great story about Butch. You know, we could stand here for hours, but we also can't let the staff stay here that long. So we'll just kind of stick to music for right now. We've got a couple more tunes, you know, and a little more to say about Butch, but this next one is a beautiful tune by Jimmy Van Heusen and Johnny Burke that was arranged by Lenny Niehaus for the Stan Kenton Orchestra. This is But Beautiful. It wouldn't be a Stan Kenton doll without also being loud in some spots. That works out great. On the alto saxophone there's Joshua Hammond. There's never a good time for a lot of things. One of the, I guess, less fortunate things of timing was we spent in the May of 2021, right after Butch retired. We had all the jazz faculty and their spouses. We all came over to Butch's house, and Butch and his wife Linda had us over. We had a little celebration for Butch in his retirement after so much teaching. And he said, on that day, right, the next Hill Country Jazz Festival we have, we're going to institute the Butch Miles Outstanding Jazz Musician Award for the outstanding solos to match each jazz festival. We're like, great, that's fantastic. So that was like May, so the next February, we're getting ready to do that. Unfortunately, we started in the, you know, as you may recall, or maybe not, because it seems forever ago, you know, the first 2 weeks of spring semester 2022, we were not back on campus. We're, you know, back to virtual again for 2 weeks. We weren't able to have the jazz festival because that left us only a week to try to get things together, and a lot of high schools that would participate weren't back in school either. So we weren't able to have the jazz festival last year, which was, you know, I mean, a bummer for many reasons, but like, okay, well, fine, we won't give up the Butch Miles Award this year. But next year, you know, we'll finally get to it. So, you know, like almost 2 years later, we're finally getting to it. But then, unfortunately, 2 days before our festival, 2 days before we gave out the award, we got word that Butch had passed. And on the night of our first Eddie Durham tribute concert up at Parker Jazz Club. So one of the nice things is that we had so many people that Butch knew that were here for that concert. Like I mentioned, Doug Lawrence was here, Lauren Schoenberg from the American Jazz Museum. We had Charlie Young, who was the lead alto player for the Duke Ellington Orchestra, was here, who been playing with the Eddie Durham tribute band, and Mike Smith, who had been a long time Frank Sinatra alto player, who Butch knew well too, was down here. So we had so many people here that had so many stories about Butch and knew him so well, and it was, you know, bittersweet to have that occasion to hear all these stories about him and everything, but it was still nice that we had so many. And we had our clinic here at the end of the festival before the Duke Ellington concert. Doug Lawrence gave the clinic, and he was, you know, right before we gave out the award, he came out and said a few words about Butch too, because, you know, a few people knew him probably as well as Doug did. He was the perfect person to have out here to talk about him. So we were able to finally this year give out the Butch Miles Outstanding Jazz Musician Award. We gave it out to two people, one because we didn't get to do it last year, and two because we had so many high schools here, we had two different venues, so we had two sets of judges, so each set of judges, both here in Evans, chose their own, so we were able to give out two of those. So finally, the first of establishing this legacy of giving out more, you know, hopefully for many, many, many years to come, just in, you know, one of our ways to pay tribute to Butch and, you know, all that he meant to us here. I do need to mention a few people in the band, because not everyone got a chance to be recognized, even though everyone was doing a fantastic job. And a lot of people got featured a little bit on Happy Go Local, you get to say it. I haven't seen all the saxophone players. Trombones played that beautiful opening to Above Beautiful. And trombone, Travis Miller. He played that great solo on I Can't Stop Loving You. Once again, lead trombone, Loud Mom. And trombone with him, Angelica Minnie Vasquez. And on bass trombone on there, Arthur Modell. Coming back this way on the trumpet. So yeah, this is Diana Gonzalez. We got two lead players. One of them is sitting down here very nicely in the front row. Is it great? Sorry, Jorge Guzman. And playing lead on that last one in this last two back right there, Alex Sabo. This next tune is another one we played with the Duke Ellington Orchestra. This is a great closer. from 1938 called Cherokee, which I'm sure you've heard one way or the other. Love the fun to solo over. It's super fast. This is going to feature on trumpet Brandon Barbie. It's going to feature James LaRue on the piano. It's going to feature Joshua Jaime on the alto sax as well. And we can't finish tonight without recognizing a very special person in the audience. Linda Benjamin Miles is able to join us tonight. And thank you so much for coming on. I know you know how much Butch meant to all of us here at Texas State, to all the students and everything. I mean, I'm sure you've heard nothing but an outpouring of how much Butch meant to so many people. And that's not going to stop him for a long time. Thank you for, letting us, we had that great party at your house. You were always so wonderful. And, I always think, what is it like to go somewhere with someone where everyone always knows, you go somewhere and everyone knows who your husband is all the time. Like, everyone's like, which one's? You think, man, this got to get kind of old after a while. Like, yes, the first one, yes, the first one. But, I mean, you'd think that Butch is one of the nicest people in the world, then, you would need to meet Linda as well, because they were a great match in so many ways, but also just two of the nicest people we've ever met, two of the most supportive people we've ever known. So thank you so much for coming tonight. It means a lot to have you here. I know all the students were very, very pleased. They're not only excited to do this concert, but also to be able to play it for you. So thank you so much. All right, so let's take it. Now, this tune actually has a little special meaning to me. When I was a freshman, 17-year-old freshman in college, I was not in the top big band my freshman year, and I listened at one concert to my school's top big band play this tune as a freshman, thinking, man, it's something I hope I get to play in that band. They played this for their jazz festival. I forget who the guest artist was, Mr. Richie Cole. But anyways, they opened up the concert with this tune, and man, it stuck in my brain forever, so I'm always happy to be able to do it with a band that I get to direct. It's really special for me. So here's Frank Mantooth's arrangement of Cherokee.